So, for those of you who don't know, what is Atomic Workstation? I think a lot of you just attended the talk by Dusty on Atomic Host, or at least I think so. So, Atomic Workstation is basically a RPM West 3, so atomic system with a workstation setup. So it has GNOME 3, network manager, and like a desktop environment. Some of the advantages as are the same as with Atomic Host, which is like we can actually test exactly the package set that you deploy as a user to your system. So for a workstation, that's a way easier way to get a working system. So some of the target audiences would be like a group of systems, like a company installation of workstations, where you probably want to have a lot of systems set up the same. If you are a developer and most of your work is done in containers or other, like it falls within the scope of Atomic Workstation, that would be a good fit as well. Or users without repair person, like if I were to ever convince my parents to use Linux, I would probably tell them to use Atomic Workstation, because you actually get a system where it's a known good package set without the usual, like, oh, I updated this thing, but not the other thing, and now stuff broke. Because that happens a lot with Fedora, surprisingly. You try not to, but it's software, it's hard. So it isn't for everyone, for all developers. Like, if you install a lot of devel packages, like glib kernel headers or other things, you might have some hardships with it. But if you are like developing web systems and you can stuff things in containers or that, it could totally work for you. It's worked for me for over 2 years now. Like, my main laptop is West 3 based. So how can you try it? Well, currently it's still experimental, as in we have a rawhide tree, which is rawhide, so it's more unstable than usual. And the Fedora 26 tree doesn't get updates because it's not part of the update composes yet. I think that we should, that we're working on that for the next releases, but that hasn't been finished yet. So one of the things I would suggest if you want to try it is don't use a VM, but use it as a dual boot installation. And one of the reasons is that you are actually trying a different kind of operating system. And with me, the first time I did it as a VM, and after 10 minutes I gave up. But if you persevere for slightly longer, you will, if you force yourself to use it more, then you will probably use it more and start to like it. So the instructions on how to get it working should be on that page. Okay, they are on that page. So side-by-side installation. Yes, if you're a developer, like, for me personally, one of the first things is I did a DNF install Flask, and it said, sorry, cannot do that. If you do more than run application, like run some graphical applications, and you actually are a developer, then yes, it will feel like it's getting in the way at the beginning. But yeah. Use case for developers, it takes getting used to. For my parents, they wouldn't care, they wouldn't notice. Okay, sure. And now Owen was going to tell about, well, how do you actually run things?
So, I mean, this is somewhat building on the last question about is it ready for your parents and some of the things we've talked about, so far, because, you know, we have this tested base operating system, and as you ship, if you just install the workstation, Atomic workstation, you'll have, you know, 3 or 4 applications, you'll have your terminal, you'll have cheese, you'll have maps, but you're not going to have much to actually, you know, the application might need to actually do things if you want more than a web browser. So the question is, how do you get more software onto there? And there are basically 3 ways I'm going to talk about adding new software to there. Sort of the way that we're targeting for your parents, for a technically non-savvy user, is Flatpak. And, you know, I had a talk about yesterday about Flatpak, but the basic idea of Flatpak is it's sort of like containers, but for desktop applications, very specialized for desktop applications. An application is sort of independent of the operating system. It has all its dependencies, and you can upgrade application without having to break your tested operating system core. And for that, we're presenting these in GNOME software. And then the question is, where do you get these Flatpaks from? And there are sort of 3 places where you might get a Flatpak. Sort of one of the goals of Flatpak is that you can get your Flatpaks from the application creators, from the person who wrote the application, whether it's an open source project, a commercial company. And, you know, that you might just go to their website, they might have a link you can click on, download and install a Flatpak. What we're expecting a lot of applications to come from for the Fedora Atomic Workstation is from Fedora itself, and we're working on taking Fedora packages and rebuilding them to be Flatpaks. That's still a work in progress. It's not something we're going to have many out there for Fedora 27, but hopefully by Fedora 28 we'll have a lot of Flatpaks. And that's probably going to be necessary to take this and make it really suitable for a novice user, is that they have this stable base and they have a good set of applications to install. Stable base without the applications to install is not as interesting. Then finally, there are people working out on there and taking software and packaging it up into Flatpaks. So if you go to flatpak.org, you can find Flatpaks for some applications, but it's not yet still sometimes feels like you're hunting around from one place to a different place to find your Flatpaks. So right now, you are somewhat of in a hunt and seek for Flatpaks, but we hope to get to the situation where you can ship the Atomic Workstation, and out of the box, there are, you know, hundreds of applications that you can install very transparently as a Flatpak. So that's what you do for a desktop application. But what if you want a server application? You need Postgres. Well, generally what we're going to say for that is you want to use containers. So Flatpaks is not a solution for server-side applications. For a lot of the typical server-side stuff, you would deploy it as a container. And containers are also generally what we say that you should be using if you do that want that development environment. If you want GCC and kernel headers, I mean, kernel is a bit of a special case, but essentially, if you want a development environment, you do that inside a container. And on the sort of trying it out instructions, we'll, that was on a previous slide, we'll go back to that link later. There's a little bit of some hints about how to set up containers to give yourself a sort of nice development environment, you know, where you can install packages, where you can install development headers, install all the tools you need without sort of breaking your main system or making that not reliable to upgrade. You know, so this is something that's sort of evolving. We really need to figure out how to have good workflows for developers that are sort of there out of the box and aren't something that everybody has to develop themselves. And then the third way is package layering. And package layering is essentially that you can, say, use these packages to extend the core operating system. Now, in some sense, that breaks the idea that what you're running on your system is exactly the same as what's been tested. And sometimes when you layer on packages, you've added a failure mechanism in upgrading because you could try to upgrade and might say, well, this package is no longer available. So it's not necessarily great for the case of unintended parents using it because we no longer say that we've tested the next version there. But it's really, really, really useful, and it's probably something that we need. It is something we need to make Atomic Workstation work for everybody right now. So let me give you an example of package layering. Say if you wanted Powerline, you could do rpmos to reinstall Powerline. It'd go out there, it would look at the Fedora repositories, find the Powerline package, but wouldn't just go ahead and install it into your current tree. It would make a new tree with all the packages in the core, plus Powerline, and then make that available for the next reboot. So that's, so you see it now is marked. So you see that if you do rpmos3 status, you see two deployments, the current one and the next one. And the next one has the has listed under layered packages Powerline. And if that layered packages line has 10 or 15 packages, that's reasonable. If that layered packages line has 100 packages, you'd probably be doing something really wrong. So after you reboot, then you see that you have Powerline is now in the current deployment, and you can use it. So there's work going on. I think it's probably pretty much landed at this point to avoid that reboot step for the initial install. I don't think it's in Fedora 26, but it should be coming to your Atomic Workstation very soon. It is Fedora 26? When I tested this at Fedora 26, it didn't work. Maybe I didn't know the magic command or something. Yes, because there's no Fedora 26 with updates, because we don't update the Fedora 26 tree. Yes. Yep. Question? I mean, I think the way you should think about it is that when you do the update, it's going to repeat the RPMOS tree install lines for the updated tree. So if you can find a new Powerline package on the updated system, it's going to use that. You know. So, you know, the problems would be if there was the new package required something which wasn't in the tree there, if the repository you're updating against is out of sync with the tree you're using, then things can go strange. But in general, it has a big advantage over a traditional system in that it's very explicit what's been layered on top. In generally, in a traditional RPM system, you have no real idea what was a part of the base, and what you added on top is extra software. So you have 3,000 undifferentiated packages, and you know you can't sort of clean up and remove what you added on top because you have no idea what that is. So question? So I mean I think it's not a simple question. It's the same question as we'd have with a Atomic Host. I think we really haven't come up with an entirely satisfactory answer to that yet. You could theoretically build a new kernel module, then put it into a repository somewhere, and then use the layering feature to layer on top, but then that would require you to be making a YUM repository available someplace, so that would be a little bit tricky. But that would probably make sense for somebody who's doing a corporate deployment, which is one of the places where it makes a lot of sense. In that case, it's pretty easy to get that going, but if it's just one user, then that's not, it's a lot harder. And certainly, kernel developers are one certain sort of target this is not a very good system for. I don't know if anybody else has any better answers about how we handle external kernel modules. Yeah? So the suggestion was that you could set it up locally on your own system, or you could make a copy, so you wouldn't have to deploy a server somewhere. I think those are both things that would probably work. I mean, it's a bit strange to be doing rpmhost relayering from a repository in your home directory, but I don't see why it wouldn't work. And certainly you could, if the proprietary the kernel module is consistent with the requirements of Copper, you could do it that way too. In the back there? So you can just do RPM. Okay. Then imports that into the OS3 there and finds in the future. Okay. So now I'm gonna switch back to Patrick, and he's gonna talk more about actually using this over a couple of years.
So as I've already said, I switched my system about 2 years ago. Some of you might have been at my talk last flock, where I was kind of hesitant to suggest to anyone to use it, because there were no real available trees. But as I said, we now actually have trees generated by us as Fedora project, Fedora Lang. I think that has improved the situation for other people to use it a lot. Getting your own trees built is still more for more advanced people. Using the trees we have, yes, I think that more people should try it and just experience it themselves, because it's a lot easier and a lot more polished nowadays after a year. Which I didn't say a year ago. So, as Owen was saying, we're adding more Flatpaks for applications in the near future. We're also trying to get actual testing of the workstation trees and updated trees. That's just not been. We only got the tree working or just barely before F26, so that's still in the working. And more documentation on how you would use it as a developer, because as we said, sometimes it requires slight changes to your development, the way you develop things. But yeah, we can just document a bunch of them, because most of the standard things, there's a solution for. You just need to know how. And I think that people should actually start trying it out now and just give it a try for seriously, and you might be going the same way as me and not ever go back after 2 years. So are there any
I would say that the RPM, the layering in RPM OS 3, in some ways that system, making it easier, and there are probably very few cases where you'd want to actually generate your tree instead of layering over the top. I'd say that that's probably most interesting if you're like a system in trying to deploy a custom thing to 1,000 systems, then you might want a custom tree that has configuration changed, has things removed, and then you know that your user would get exactly what you tested. And you know, I think that the RPM OS tree is always improving in terms of making the compose process better, but it's still, you know, it's still something you have to spend a little time to learn how to do, and then you have to have a server somewhere to serve those trees up. For applications, we don't spit out translations in separate packages, so we're still actually, probably the workstation OS 3 has probably most of, has a lot of translations for other languages, but just missing some of the ELFC pieces, so I think we should have the same languages we have in like the live, the standard workstation install ISO. Images, if you go to not to the where it says direct link, but you go to where it says the other link it gives, and then navigate down two levels, you'll find them. Yeah, Dan? I think some of that is just, what Dan said is that, you know, for developers it's still very rough in some ways because you get confused between are you looking at container or looking at the host. And some of that I think can be solved in the user interface, like if, you know, making it more clear when you have a terminal inside the, that's a container terminal versus the main terminal. We sort of have to, in some ways, we have to make the ways of developing that work on Atomic Host the standard ways of doing it, instead of sort of the old-fashioned let's replace stuff inside the user, because I mean, they have a lot of other advantages as well if you can actually work that way. Thank you.
people